You know, I keep pulling this track out when it's time for acoustic streams, and I don't know why, it just seems to work really, really well. James is massively fading the track out as we speak. Hi guys, how you doing? It's Monday evening. We're doing the thing we do on Monday evenings, just hang out and talk about the guitar. And my name is Nick Jennison on behalf of Guitar Interactive Magazine. Great to have you back. If you're one of our returning streamers, hey, listen, thanks for joining us again. We are down in the GI headquarters in London, filming some reviews for you guys. Not this Takamine. We did that last time. It's coming. But we've got some really, really good stuff coming for you. If you're new to our little Monday night streams, hey, welcome. It's good to have you on board. We are going to talk about the guitar. We're going to do some lesson stuff today where we're going to learn a little bit about our playing, learn a little bit about how we can become better guitar players. It's the sort of thing that we like to do on Monday evening. So, hey, listen, if you're a returning streamer or if you're a new viewer, either way, great to have you on board. So, before we get too deep into the weeds with this stuff, just want to take a quick second and shout out the sponsor of today's stream. This evening's stream is brought to you by our friends at Elixir Strings, who've been kind enough to sponsor yet another stream of ours. They're really, really good to us. So if you want to help us keep the lights on, you want to help us keep doing what we're doing here, if you're getting use out of the streams that we're doing every Monday evening, we're going to keep going regardless. But if you're enjoying what we're doing, you can help us out by heading to the link in the description, which will take you to Elixir's social media. It'll take you to the Elixir website. Go check out some Elixir strings. They're really great. Now, I have strung this guitar up with a set of Elixir 12s, which is a little heavier than I'd normally use. The reason for this is because we're going to talk about how a guitar like this can help to bulletproof your technique. Now, bulletproof is one of those buzzwords that gets used all the time in the fitness space, and I use it with my tongue very firmly in cheek because it normally means some nonsense. But today what we're going to do is we're going to talk about how playing acoustic and how practicing on acoustic can help you develop a really robust technique that is impervious to changes in gear, in guitar, in conditions, in location, all that sort of thing. The sort of technique where you can just pick up an instrument, no matter what that instrument is, and play really well. Fingers crossed. Ultimately, we'd all like to be able to do that, right? So we'll talk more about that in a bit. Before we do, a couple of other ways you can help us keep the lights on. You can give this video a thumbs up on whatever platform you happen to be watching on. You can also share this video with your guitar playing friends. We would love to get this out to as many guitar players as possible. And also, you can drop us a comment down below. Now, the algorithm loves some comments, so your comments are always, always, always welcome. But also, we're going to be answering your questions as we go on over the course of the evening. So if you have questions, don't forget, you can also comment those down below. If you have questions, drop them in the comments. We'll answer them as we go on. Speaking of comments, let's just take a quick second and say hello to our friends in the comment section. Let's see who's here. We've got a whole bunch of new friends and old friends kicking around. It's always lovely to hear from you. So first one through the door, once again, is our friend Marcin, who was always the first one here, apart from a couple of weeks when he wasn't, and we started to worry, but he's back now. So, Marcin, great to have you. Marcin says, time to dust off my acoustic. Good thing I have Elixirs on it, so everything will be fine for sure, man. I think you might remember the last acoustic stream we did where I dug out the court guitar that's been living in my storage locker for about a year, and it had a set of Elixirs on from some previous Elixir streams last year, I think, and man, they were still fine. They still played great. Stayed in tune. They were great. They worked really, really well. So yeah, we love a bit of that. Marcin says, don't forget to like the video, guys. What he said, don't forget to like the video for sure. Who else do we have in the house? Response Audio is here. Always, always good with some insightful stuff. Really went down a rabbit hole trying to use my thumb and fingers this week. I got a lot out of the lesson with Jared last week. Now next week, just to let you guys know, next week we are going to be doing a stream on what we learned from the Jared James Nichols session. So that's coming next week. So fear not, we're gonna be revisiting that. I'm not gonna leave you out in the wilderness with, hey, Jared said to do all this cool stuff. But man, what a lush hangout that was. He's such a great guy, man. Just an absolute gent. Now, what I will say is that when we do these streams, when we do interviews with, we're looking up to interview with, to have interviews with some really fabulous artists, right? And sometimes people are, they're nice off camera, but they're not really as exuberant as they are on camera. Some people have the kind of the alter ego thing, and that's totally fine, right? There's nothing wrong with that. Most of the people we meet, almost all of them, are absolutely fabulous. And everybody we've had on stream has been just wonderful, right? But Jared is one of those guys who is exactly the same off camera as he is on camera. He just rolls out of bed like that. Just a real great dude, fantastic talent. I had a lot of fun with that. So next week we will be doing the What We Learned from the Jared James Nichols stream. So who else do we have in the house? This is a really good one here. It says there's a Tim Pierce video where he analyzes one of Jared's solos. The title is, I've never heard him play like this. Do we need to start using titles like that? I wonder if that's it. Maybe we need to start clickbaiting hard. If it's good enough for Tim Pierce, good enough for us. I love me some Tim Pierce. What a player. Anyway, who else do we have in the house? PJ's here. Oh, wow, I feel late, says PJ. Good evening. Great to have you on board. David Yates is here. Says, evening, Marcin, Response Audio, Nick, and everyone. Unfortunately, I am an acoustic-free zone at the minute, but I'm here for moral support and smash the like button. You should smash the like button too. David, you can play this sort of thing that we're going to talk about. It doesn't have to be acoustic. I'm doing it on an acoustic, but you can do it on most any guitar. But I would suggest, if you have a guitar that maybe plays a little stiffer than your other guitars, that's a good shout. Or if you have a sound that's maybe a little more difficult to play through, that's a good shout too. Because we're going to talk about that. The acoustic is just an analogy for what we're going to talk about, which is why I have it with me today. Who else do we have? Larry Warren is in the house. Larry, it is great to see you. Timothy Appling is here. Daryl Queen is here. All the usual candidates. Sacred Godslayer is in the house. Our regulars are all here. Cranker Tom is here. Love to see you. Who else do we have? Let's just quickly say hello. Helmet Strap is here. Again, great to have you on board. Kim is saying hello. Kim sat right here. He's waving at the camera as we speak, but you guys can't see him, but he's smiling. So there we go. That's a good sign. Cowcat is in the house. Good to see you. D-Mac is back. It's been a little while, man. How have you been? Hope you're keeping well. It's good to have you back on board. Who else do we have? A new friend in Hull FC 2005. I had to think about that. I'm not very good at reading usernames. I keep reading them wrong. Good to have you on board, man. I don't know if you're a first-time viewer, but I think you're a first-time commenter. If you are, then hey, welcome on board. My friend Craig says, what the Takamine is going on? This guitar just happens to be here, man. But it's really nice. Like, it's a great guitar. It has that kind of, I guess that kind of 90s tack sound. I suppose you can call it the 70s and 80s tack sound, really. I always think about it as the 90s Takamine sound, but it has that old school Takamine thing where it's not the most like super like natural sounding acoustic in the world, but it's a really cool sound that, you know, we're all used to. We grew up listening to this. We grew up listening to Bon Jovi and Springsteen and the Eagles and all these guys playing these 70s style tacks and these 80s style tacks with this kind of brown preamp. It kind of has that going on, which I really, really like. A review is coming, coming very, very soon. So anyway, who else do we have? Who else do we have in the house? I think that is all of our friends in the comments. So if you guys have questions, don't forget, drop them in the comments. We'll be answering them as we go on over the course of this evening's stream. Now, once again, just want to take a quick second before we go further and remind you guys that today's stream is brought to you by our friends at Elixir Strings, who've been kind enough not only to sponsor this stream and help us bring these streams to you, they are a returning partner who've been really, really good to us over the years, and they've enabled us to bring loads of streams to you. So make sure you check out the socials, check out the links down below. But they've also been kind enough to bring the strings for this guitar. It's strung up with 12s. Now, you guys may know that when I play my own acoustics, I generally play with 11s, sometimes even 10s. But what I'm gonna do with you here is I'm gonna pose a hypothetical to you. Now, this is something that actually happened to me. It's not so much a hypothetical thing, but it's something that I actually had to contend with for a while. So, my job, a part of my job, with Guitar Interactive magazine is I review guitars. So you guys know this, right? Now I review amps, review guitars. Oftentimes what this means is that I don't get to play my own instruments every time I'm on camera, right? There are things that live on the internet in permanence where I'm playing and I'm playing a guitar that maybe isn't the easiest to play. Maybe it's a cool guitar. Maybe it's set up really well, but set up really well for somebody who isn't me. Maybe it's a cool guitar that is designed to play a little bit stiffer or is designed to play a bit different. Maybe it's an acoustic guitar, maybe it's a nylon string, something like that. Maybe I'm playing through a pedal or an amp that isn't the kind of tone that I normally go for. Ultimately, what I'm experiencing is being out of my comfort zone with my gear. Now, some other situations that I find myself in, this is not just a woe is me. These are all cool situations, right? I'm glad of it, but other situations I find myself in is there will be occasions where I have to play having not touched a guitar for a couple of days and having taken, say, for example, international flights or traveled the length of a country in a van or something like that. Or maybe a lot of the times, like when I used to come down here initially to shoot earlier on in my tenure with Guitar Interactive and with our sister company, Lick Library, I would often turn up and I'd have a hotel booked, and the hotel's fine, but I just wouldn't sleep for whatever reason. I don't know if it was nerves or if it was just like not being used to sleeping in hotels or whatever, but I would come in kind of sleep deprived and sort of like half asleep and all that sort of thing. All of these are scenarios where the technique that you've cultivated in your practice space on your own gear with gear that's set up absolutely beautifully and just works fantastically well for the sort of playing you like to do, all of that stuff is out of the window. And suddenly you have to play well on 2 hours sleep on a guitar that's way stiffer than you're used to playing on through an amp that is not necessarily something you'd go for anyway. You get the gist of it, right? And oftentimes it'll happen, say for example, we're going to NAMM again this year in January. Looking forward to it, can't wait. But what we're going to be doing is I'll be expected to jump in front of the camera, pick up a guitar and play. And I will be expected to play at the apex of my abilities, because that's literally what I'm there for. I am there to play the guitar at people. And it's not the easiest thing in the world. So what I started doing is I started seeking out ways to be able to play on any instrument with minimal or no preparation, so no warm-up, and to be able to adapt to an instrument very, very quickly. And what this led me to was practicing on acoustic guitars, and specifically acoustic guitars that are set up a little on the stiff side. So, if you have an acoustic guitar, we're gonna do some stuff together, and we're gonna see what we can conjure in terms of finding some stuff that is challenging for you. So let's begin with some technical things. Let's go to the two hands close-up cam if we can, James. So over the last few weeks, we've been using this particular scale shape for a lot of our shred exercise that we've been playing. So G major scale shape, where maybe we might play, for example, 3, 5, and 7 on the lowest two strings, 4, 5, and 7 on the next two strings, and then 5, 7, and 8 on the highest two strings. So we have 3, 5, 7, 4, 5, 7, and then 5, 7, 8 on the highest two strings. Now here's a little challenge for you. We're gonna begin by playing this, and we're gonna see if we can play it using a variety of different techniques. And what you'll notice is if you're used to playing this on electric guitars, and you're used to playing this kind of like shreddy stuff that we've been looking at over the last few weeks, some things may happen that may prove challenging for you. And it's gonna reveal some things about our playing that we can then address. So let's go back to the close-up cam. What we're gonna start by doing is we're gonna start by doing this with some hammer-ons. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to play two runs on each string. So if we start on the lowest string, we might play low, middle, high, low, middle, high. We'll play that same thing, 6 notes in total, on every string. It's gonna give us this. Now what I wanna know from you, when we do this together, is first of all, Can you, we can stay on this campus, James, that's fine. We can, what I know from you, I want to know from you is, can you play it? And does anything weird happen on any of the strings in particular? Does it end up going very quiet? Does it end up feeling very challenging? Let's do it together a few times. So I'm going to start here. Let's try it together. I'm going to play. Let's try it again. Ready? 3, 4. And again, 3, 4. Now, is that something that you're able to do? Let me know in the comments, right? This is an important thing, because what I want to know from you is, does this feel okay? Does it feel weird? Does it feel more challenging than it would in your electric guitar? Or does it feel about fine? Now, if you're not playing an acoustic this week, that's fine. If you're playing electric, that's totally cool. What I'd encourage you to do is I'd encourage you to find a guitar sound to play with that's maybe a little bit more difficult to play through. An example of this, everybody has one of these. We have a kryptonite tone that we can't really play our best through. And for me, the most kryptonite-y of kryptonite tones for the longest time was not an edge of breakup tone, that's cool. Clean tones were fine. Distorted tones, absolutely fine. But when you got, say, a Marshall amp, and you get it to the point where it distorts when you hit a chord, but it's clean the rest of the time. That drives me crazy, right? I used to hate playing through that tone. And I would practice on that tone, because I'm like, I don't like that tone, and I don't play well on that tone, so I'm gonna practice using that tone. The acoustic guitar is just an analog for this. It's just a way of making this more difficult, and using the instrument as a way of making things difficult. So here we go. We've got a few comments in already. Marcin, it's okay for him. Who else do we have? D-Max says Pinky is weaker on an acoustic. Now, D-Max, what I wanna know from you, is it weaker on all of the strings, or is it only weaker on the highest two strings? So let me know. If it's weaker on all the strings, if it's weaker on the highest two strings, then that's interesting. Okay, PJ says, my strings run out of energy. Yep, that's a common thing indeed. Timothy Appling says, it's more challenging. Marcin says, I'm glad I didn't stick with the original plan of becoming a bassist. Well, I mean, all I say, if you are a great bassist, you'll never be short of work. That's for sure. You know, there's not that many of them out there. But D-Max says, weakest on the highest two, for sure. Okay. Helmer Strap says, the action on my acoustic is horrible, too high. That does not help me. It doesn't help you do this stuff easily, but it may help you in the long run. Sacred Godslayer says, okay at this speed. Okay, well, let's speed it up. So we'll go a little bit faster with this. Same exercise, but let's just see what happens, right? So if we try playing a little faster, it might be that it's actually easier faster, because the string doesn't have to vibrate for as long. So maybe if we go like this. Now what you'll notice there is, for me, these notes right here, they're a lot quieter than these notes. Quieter. Bit louder. But let's try it together anyway. So we go. Go 1, 2, 3, 4. And again, 3, 4. Again, what I'm noticing in my own playing here is the highest two strings, things are getting a little bit difficult. So I can make an observation there about my playing, and I can go, okay, something's happening. And it could be one of two things. Either the hammer-ons between 3 and 4 or what's difficult, or the hammer-ons on the plain strings, or what's difficult. I don't know what's making it difficult at this point. Is it the plain strings, or is it the fact that it's 3 and 4? Now, for someone like D-Mac, or any of you guys that have had this experience where you go, wow, this is fine until I hit the plain strings, we now need to make some deductions, because we've learned something about ourselves. We've learned that, okay, this is difficult, and it's quieter than the other ones. Why is it quieter? And what's going on? So what I'm gonna do here is we're gonna eliminate the variable of the plain strings. And we're gonna see if we can play the same thing on the wound strings. Plain strings being the highest two, wound strings being the lowest four on your typical acoustic guitar. Now, if it turns out that playing this 1-3-4 pattern on the wound strings is fine And then when we get to the plain strings, it's difficult. That tells me one thing. If it turns out that it's just difficult on all of the strings, then it tells me another thing. So let's figure it out together. What I'm going to do for this is I'm going to read you my exercise. So I'm going to play 1, 3, 4 on all of the strings. And I'm going to play this. And would you look at that? It's a little bit quiet on all of them. So what this means is that we're not necessarily getting quieter notes in the plain strings. I'm just getting quieter notes between fingers 3 and 4, if that makes sense. Craig's talking about the sound here. Yeah, I totally agree, right? The snappy upper mids thing. It's just that classic tack sound. Like, you will have heard that sound on like Blaze of Glory and all that sort of thing, or the Springsteen, like, I love it, absolutely love it. It's not, again, it's not a super like really, really natural acoustic sound, but it doesn't have to be. Acoustic can sound like, plugged in acoustic sounds can be really cool, especially if they're really characterful like this, but it does have that very characteristic, like, plugged in-y thing. So here we go. This one from DMAC says, I think it's that there's less tension on the wound strings. There could well be. Now, these feel pretty well balanced. That's another thing with the 12 set, is the 12 set is pretty well balanced across the board. Certainly, the gauges Elixir's use, which I think are standard. I'm not sure. I'm not 100% sure what they are. I know it's 12 on the top, that's for sure. And I think it's 53 on the bottom. Now, I chose these because they are a little bit tougher than the strings I would typically play. So we're trying to make it hard for ourselves here. Now, going back to my problem that I've discovered. So one of the things I've learned about myself here is that this hammer-on business between 3 and 4, that's a bit of a challenge. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna earmark that and go, okay, that's a part of my technique that isn't bulletproof. Hammer-ons between fingers 3 and 4. Other fingers, no problem. Fingers 1, 2, 4, fine. 1, 3, 4, not so much. 1, 2, 3, probably fine. So if I play 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 across all the strings like this, that's okay. Still a little quiet. 1, 2, 4 across all the strings. Absolutely fine. 1, 3, 4. Needs a little more work. Now, this could mean a few things. It could mean that my finger 4 is weak hammering on. It could be my finger 3 is weak hammering on. It could also mean that my finger 3 is weak when it's hammering on and it's going to be followed by finger 4, which I think is what's happening. So I think there's one weird little thing that I'm doing where when I'm about to go to finger 4, finger 3 does some weird stuff. So what I might do here is I might do this again and I might start analyzing my technique and say, what am I doing differently here? What's changed? I know what the answer is, and I'm going to spoiler it for you even still, but what I'm doing here is I'm not quite catching finger 3 on the bone of the finger. Now, we've talked about this before. When we do hammer-ons, it's very important that the bone is the thing that hits the string, not the flat of the finger, not the fleshy part of the finger, but the bone of the finger. Very quickly, let's do this together, right? I wanna take finger number 1, we're gonna hammer on to fret number 5 on the A string. And we're not actually gonna pick it at all, we're just gonna hammer on. And what I want you to do is I want you to use the very bone of your finger, the very tip of the finger bone, see what it sounds like, and then move your finger a little higher and start using the fleshy part of the finger instead. Notice how quiet that is. Comparison to the bone. Now the finger bone is the hardest part of the finger and transfers force way better into the string than the flat part of the finger. So I've revealed a tendency in my own fingering thing here where I'm playing with a little bit of kind of like flatness on the finger here as opposed to playing on the bone. Now that is, for me, a laziness in position. Because my third finger is quite long, you guys can see it there, it's quite a long third finger, and my fourth finger is quite short, I have to get way up on my tips to play accurately with my third finger. Now listen to the difference there. If I do this, not very loud, if I do this, way up on my tips, loads clearer, way louder. I would not have learned this about myself had I sat and played on my electric guitar. Now, why is this? The reason for this is because my electric guitar is very forgiving. It's a performance instrument. I've set up all my electrics to perform, to be essentially transparent. To, you know, I don't need to think about playing them. They just play. They play themselves. almost. That's not to say that they are quite easy to play. It's not to say that the easiest instruments in the world to play. There's a bit of resistance in them. But for me, I play and they just feel completely transparent. Whatever I go for, it just works. Now, that's the way your instrument should be set up. Your instrument should be set up, I think, to just work with your particular playing style. Whether that's easy, whether it's hard, it doesn't really matter, as long as it works. Now, because of that, I can get away with certain flaws in my technique, like that, where I'm not quite catching the bone on finger number three when I'm ready to go to finger number four. I would never have noticed this in a million years on my electric. It would have just sounded fine. It wouldn't have sounded like a problem. However, when I play an electric guitar that isn't set up very well, or an electric guitar that's set up in a way that I don't like, or through an amp tone that doesn't give me what I want, that's going to reveal itself and I won't know why. But because we've systematized this with my acoustic guitar, with this challenging setup on the acoustic guitar that I've purposely dialed in, I've been able to recognize that and I can change it. How am I going to change it? Well, I'm going to change it by cueing myself for bone on the third finger. That's all I'm reaching for. And I'm going to encourage you to do the same thing. So D-Mac in particular, reach for the very bone of your third finger. So what we're going to get is this. This is the previous technique. Notice how that just so quickly runs out of energy when we get to the high two strings. Let me cue myself for bones down, where I get the bone of the finger doing the hammer on. Way louder. Tons louder. Let's do it again. Just light years better. There's still a little bit of a difference between the pick notes and the hammer-on notes, that's fine, but it's not this vanishing tone that it was before. So I've just remedied something there, and that's really useful. Now, let's move on to something else. Let's do some picking stuff. So here's a challenge I'm gonna give you. We're gonna do some more picking, and this time we're gonna play exactly the same thing. We're gonna play across the same scale shape, but this time with our picking, our goal is not so much accuracy, it's dynamic evenness. Now, we talked about this in one of our previous acoustic streams. What do I mean by that? Well, what we tend to do as guitar players is we tend to emphasize certain notes when we don't necessarily mean to. We don't necessarily have full control over the dynamics of our playing. Some notes will end up being soft because we're unable to strike them hard enough or with enough authority or with the right technique, let's say. Other notes will be loud just because we've had to do something weird to get it. So, let's explore. We're gonna go back to those two cameras. What we're gonna do here is we'll play the same thing. Three notes up on each string. And then we're gonna play, well, we'll play it with picking this time. So it's gonna be an alternate picking thing. And we'll go like this. Now here's what we're looking for. We're looking for an even dynamic across all the notes, but we're also looking for all the notes to be joined up and not to be back-a-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. This should be fairly joined. Spun my pick around in my hand as I was doing that one. Let's do it again. That sounds pretty even, especially towards the end. I want to know from you if you can do this. So let's do it together. We're going to start a little slower. Let's go. Ready? Two, three. Let's try it again. One, two, three, four. Let me know in the comments if this is working for you, if it's something that you're able to do, or if you notice any weirdness going on in your technique. Now, I've noticed some weirdness in my own technique here, and let me troubleshoot it for you. Now, this is something that, because I've practiced this a lot, I was able to adapt to and it was fine. But what I noticed was, I have a tendency when I'm playing this stuff, I have a tendency to dig in a little too hard and maybe play the notes a little bit louder than I want to. But what happens is, when I feel the resistance of the string, instead of just being able to roll with it and just let the string, like let the pick flop over the string and release a bit of tension to allow it to flop past the string, I end up pushing harder. Let me show you what I mean. So if I go here and I play this first couple of notes, I've pushed on that string to make some to make the pick move. But because these strings are very stiff, the string is not going to give. It's giving a little bit, but it's not giving enough that it yields to the pick. So what I do is, instead of relaxing, allowing the pick just to flop over the top of the string, like it should, what I'm doing instead is I'm just applying more pressure, and I'm going like this. This particularly reveals itself when I'm doing economy picking, like we just did there, but we're gonna get to that. Now, here's a comment from Sacred Godslayer. It says, it's hard, especially on sextuplets, and you've practiced a lot with accents on the beats. For sure, this is the Paul Gilbert thing, where we accent very hard on the downbeat, on whatever we're playing, and that's fine. This is a perfectly fine way to play. However, it's fine when we're playing electric guitar. It's fine when we're playing an electric guitar with a restricted dynamic range, like a distorted electric guitar, because those accents serve as timekeeping things for ourselves, but they don't necessarily serve as dynamic accents in the sense that they're actually louder than they would be. Whereas if you're playing on an acoustic guitar, if we accent this downbeat, we might get this. Quite hard to do. Now, first of all, those big swingy accents, it's just bouncing my pick out of position because these strings are so stiff, I can't move them with this small pick that I'm playing with. If I had a large pick, then maybe I could. I'm playing with a jazz size pick today to make it even harder for myself, but I'm actually really enjoying these for phrasing on the electric guitar. We'll get to that, but this sort of thing. That's tough. Now, that works really well on the electric guitar, but what we need to do on our acoustic guitar is, I think we need to, or certainly for the practice, I think we need to make these accents more of a mental thing. We need to imagine the downbeat accent rather than actually playing it. And that's the difference between this, which is the thing we're just talking about, this business here where we play. And this. Which is way more even across the, it's not super even, there's still some variance there, but it's a lot more smooth and even across the fretboard. Now, here's where things get a little more challenging. What we're gonna do next is we're gonna do the same thing, but this time we're gonna start to incorporate some other technical elements, which might be things like economy picking. Now, economy picking, for those of you guys who do this stuff, is essentially where we include some kind of sweeping movement within our picking technique. So for example, this is something that's very challenging on acoustic guitar. I think, personally, I find it basically kryptonite, because what I tend to do for economy picking is I use the resistance of the string to help me with timing. I probably shouldn't do that. I probably shouldn't let the string dictate the timing. I should probably dictate the timing with the pace of my hand. And the acoustic guitar is not gonna let me do that, because if I let the string dictate how fast I'm going across the strings with the sweep, it's just not gonna work. It'll just, like, my pick will bounce off, it will deflect. And let me show you what I mean by that. So, here's an economy picking thing we can do with this sort of thing. What we might do is we might play, instead of playing this, or even this, what we might do is we might only play one note on the middle string. The middle string in this case is the A string. So we might play low, middle, high on the low string, only the middle note on the A string, and then low, middle, high again on the next string. That gives us 3, 5, 7, 5 on A, 4, 5, 7 on D, this. Now what I want to know from you is, first of all, is this a lick that you can play? So we'll do it together, let's go like this. Is that something you're able to play? Do you have difficulty with it? And if you do, what part do you have difficulty with? Let me know in the comments. I want to know what's going on here, because I can diagnose some stuff with this in my own technique. And let me tell you what it is. Now, this is something I already know about, because when I'm playing this stuff, especially when I'm improvising, I have this horrible habit I've noticed, which again, I can get away with this stuff on my electric that's just set up really, really friendly and works really, really well and all that sort of thing. Here's a good one from Sacred Godslayer again, saying, I must exercise more stiffness in the wrist in order to obtain an even sound. I think it might be the opposite. I think you might need less stiffness in the wrist. Now, let's talk about even sound very quickly before we get back to the economy picking thing. Hold that thought, but let me know what's going on with your economy picking in the comments. What you might think of is even sound. Can be, if your sound is up here and down here and all over the place, if that's your dynamic range, you can have an even sound where everything's up here, but we can still have an even sound if everything's down here. If all the notes are down here, it's going to be even. Let me show you, right? If I play very softly, apart from missing a few notes because it's too soft, that's quite even. I'm playing very softly there, I'm tickling the guitar. If I play very hard, also even, but even at loud volumes rather than at quiet volumes. So it might be that you actually need less, or you may need to play a little more gently. This will have the side effect of also, first of all, it feels nice. It feels very, it feels almost like a spa for the hands. It's very, very nice. It feels soothing in a way that this hard technique doesn't. That sounds cool, and there's times to use that, but it's not always the thing. But also this more evenly matches the sound of your hammer-ons and pull-offs. So maybe a softer technique might work. Maybe that's one of those things. Sacred Godslayer says, it's not a matter of strength, it's about controlling the sway of the wrist. 100%, right? Me and Jared talked about this last week. Talked about this business that guitar is not about strength. We are two big gym rats, right? Jared is even bigger than I am. He's 6'5". It's unbelievable, right? The guy must have hands the size of most people's feet. It's crazy, right? Just massive big hands on him. And does he play with all of his might? No. Does he have to? No. So yeah, not a strength game for sure. So anyway, going back to our economy picking example real quick. Here's an interesting one from Daryl Queen, by the way. Says, I find I have to lighten my pick attack to get the same volume as my quietest legato phrases. For sure, for sure. And a light pick attack is something that we can easily lose when it comes to our electric guitar. We can easily lose that because it's so easy to dig in. We don't feel the consequences of digging in. Because the worst that happens on an electric guitar with tens on it or anything like that is you dig in and the string just moves. It'll bounce. You dig in too hard with 12s or 13s on an acoustic guitar, it's going to bounce your pick off that string. The string will say no. It is a powerful enough string that it'll just go, oh, you want to dig in, do you? No, not happening, right? That pick is bouncing, and your natural reflex will be to grip in response. We start to grip really hard. We start to crush our pick and deform it in our hands. That's the tension we could do without. That's going to slow you down. It's going to make you less fluid and more clumsy as a guitar player. Now, going back to our economy picking example, here's the, just to remind you what's going on here, by the way, it's a phrase that runs thus. We play 3-5-7 on the low E string, 5 on the A string, and then 4-5-7 on the D string, like this. Now this reveals a tendency in my playing that I know I need to fix. I need to spend more time with it. And I can get away with this on my electric guitar in a way that I can't with the acoustic guitar. So what do I mean by that? Well, the tendency is, I have a tendency when I'm playing the sweep portion of this lick to use the tension of the string as a timing mechanism. So what I do is I dig in more or less to slow the pick down enough that it's in time. It's a bad habit, I shouldn't do this, but I can get away with it is the point. So I can get away with this on my electric. So I'm like, well, you know, why should I fix it? Well, we've already talked about that because it means, yes, I can do it on my own guitar. I can do it on a guitar that's set up and works really well for me. But what I can't do is play it as fluently on a guitar like this, where it's an acoustic guitar and I don't have compression and distortion and all that sort of thing, and I don't have a really nice comfortable setup with 10s instead of 12s on it, it messes me up. What I should be doing is I should be generating my timing, or using, what I should be doing is I should be making the timing right by just moving my hand at the speed that it's supposed to go. But instead, what I'm doing is I'm pressing on the string hard enough that it flops over at the right point. Shouldn't do that. And I'm hearing that when I play these lines. Certainly on the lowest strings here. There. For some reason, that's okay. That feels all right. That feels fine. That feels less fine. Why is that? Well, it's because I'm digging in too hard. I'm digging in an effort to keep my timing right. And I shouldn't be doing that. And I know I shouldn't be doing that. Why? Because I practiced it on my acoustic guitar. Right, so how am I going to fix it? Well, you know what I'm going to do. I'm going to do the same thing that I did with my my legato technique, where what I do is I go, okay, here's what I know I need to not do. I need to not dig in on those sweeps. I need to keep nice and smooth feeling. That also means probably not digging in on the alternate picking part of it either, because if you dig in on these strokes, you're going to continue digging in on these. And that's never going to feel super comfortable or natural, and certainly going to inhibit my timing. May not inhibit yours, who knows, but for me, that's definitely going to be a, that's going to be a problem. So what I'm going to do here instead is I'm going to focus on the lightness of my pick. That's harsh. That's what I'm trying to play. That's what I'm looking for here, right? So that lightness, even up there, that's going to keep me right. It means what I'm doing there is I'm moving my hand at the speed that it's supposed to move at to keep the timing good, rather than just using the bounce of the string to deflect me back into time. That's one of those things. So here's a question from Marcin. It says, do you switch to thinner picks for acoustic playing? I usually switch to flow 1 millimeter. Depends. Now here's the thing, with acoustic guitars, I think the gauge of the pick has a much more profound effect on the tone. So for example, I'm using a Jazz 3 right now. It's an Ultex Jazz 3 that's a little bit worn, doesn't have much of a tip on it, which is also useful for this stuff. It doesn't have the pointiest tip, because that's gonna force me not to rely on the tip of the pick to grab the string when I'm playing this stuff. What I would do if I was performing or I was recording and this pick was a little bit worn, I'd be like, oh, well, I'll grab a new one with a fresh tip, because then it'll just work. But here, I'm like, actually, I want the challenge. I want the challenge of playing with the worn pick. Now, Nick Harrison's in the chat. Nick, it's good to have you. Good to have you on board. Good to see you. That's what I'm trying to say. Nick would encourage me to practice with like picks that I didn't like. So he would literally send me like, I'm trying to think, it was like orange Tortex picks in the post. Now, I like Tortex picks. Don't like normal, regular, just regular shape, regular size picks. Definitely don't like the orange ones for picking with, because they flop around too much. So practicing with something like that is another part of this business of setting the guitar up in a way that's difficult for you. So it reveals things about your playing. With just devastating accuracy. It's like, yeah, you can't do this as well as you think you can. You can do it when the conditions are all right, but can you do it on an acoustic guitar, on 4 hours sleep, etc. You know, with somebody watching going, this is the greatest acoustic guitar in the world, you should try it. And, you know, like, there's money on the line, like, oh, geez, I better be able to play. Yeah, for sure. So going back to the question anyway, I think for acoustic guitars, what I'll do is I'll switch to a thinner pick for tonal reasons. So if I'm strumming, I'll switch to a thinner pick. But I'll actually generally play with a much bigger pick if I'm playing flat picking ideas. So I'll even go to like, if I'm playing flows, I'll go up to a 2 mil as opposed to the 1.5 that I would normally use, for example. So, you know, horses for courses here. Anyway, we got a cool comment from Sacred Godslayer. Says, I have the problem you mentioned with upstroke economy picking. Had this problem for ages and haven't been able to correct it. Well, here's the thing, right? You've been able to identify it now, and identifying it is part of the way of fixing it. Now, in terms of how you fix it, there are lots of roads to, I was going to say lots of roads to Rome. I don't want that to be a pun. I know Sacred Godslayer is our Italian correspondent, but there's no other phrase. There are lots of roads to Rome here, where there's lots of ways. We have a phrase in English, lots of phrase to skin a cat, lots of ways to skin a cat, which I always find a bit cruel. Like, what are those cats done? Actually, cats can be pretty vicious, so maybe they've done so. Anyway, we're not talking about skinning cats. So in terms of fixing this, it's more about focusing on playing without doing the thing. So that's kind of a negative way of looking at it. So the way we might do it is we might look for the quality that we don't see in our playing. So for example, the quality, rather than framing it as like don't dig in, that's not very useful. If we frame it instead as do play lightly, feel the lightness of the pick on the upstroke. Ah. Helps you can play lines that work. Etc. If you work on feeling the lightness rather than eliminating the tension, that might work a little better for you. So again, it's something that we can actually focus on rather than a negative, if that makes sense. Daryl Queen says, I'm nicking this exercise. There's a hole in my own playing as well, for sure. Now, the interesting thing is you might not notice this as a hole on your own guitars when you're playing in your comfort zone where everything's just set up to work, right? You might not notice it as a hole in your playing, but you might notice it on something like this, for example. So here's one last little scenario where this might be useful. Oh, here's a cool one from Daryl Queen as well. It says, also, it's also a useful hand shape for running some more colorful extended chord voicings I'm trying to get in my playing. For sure, right? This, a lot of the diagonals thing is useful for this sort of thing. And sometimes it's fun just to see what a particular like shape of hand sounds like. What does it sound like when my hand's shaped like this versus when it's shaped like this versus when it's shaped like this or shaped like that or shaped like that? Who knows? It can be fun just to go looking and just let the actual physical shape of the hand take you places. Now, here is another, one more scenario where this thing is really, really useful. So I've recently been learning some songs from the forthcoming Blitzkrieg album to play live. So these are songs that I put together, put some like loads of guitar layers in them. They're not out yet, unfortunately. As soon as they're out, I'll let you know. But we are going to be playing some live for some of our forthcoming tour dates. Now, to be announced. We haven't announced them yet, so I can't tell you where they are. But some of the solos, I improvised them, and they're really quite challenging. And I'm like, man, this is tough, right? But what I started doing was I started practicing them on my acoustic. And the reason for this was, truthfully, myself and my partner Nina, we were getting ready to go out. And because I'm just a hairy savage, I'd take no time at all to get ready. And because she's very well groomed, she takes a good length of time to prepare herself for going places, right? So she was in the back room getting ready, where all the mirrors are and all that sort of stuff. And normally I'll just practice in there. That's my little practice space. And I wanted to give her a bit of space just to do what she does. So I went downstairs, grabbed my acoustic, which is kicking around downstairs, sat in the front room, you know, on the sofa, and I thought, I'll just keep practicing this solo, and noticed how impossibly challenging this solo had become on the acoustic. And a lot of the areas that I was just like bluffing my way through became glaringly apparent on the acoustic guitar. They just like revealed themselves as, you're not really doing that right though, are you? And I'm like, right, I don't want this. I've written these solos. I want them to be great. I want them to perform really, I want to perform really, really well. I better crack these. So for example, there's a phrase in one of the songs. The song is called The Spider. And there's this really great phrase. The solo goes, That's easy enough. Wow, that's tough. So if I play... let me remind myself. That's challenging. So once again. Again. Ew, that's really tough. So what I figured out there is I was tightening up at the bottom of that scale shape down, that little fragment down there. In the way that we just talked about. And similarly here, I didn't get that jump. That little position shift. I was just like playing that very, very sloppily and getting away with it because I was playing on an electric guitar with loads of distortion because it's a heavy metal band and we're playing heavy metal solos. But that really revealed itself on the acoustic. And it's what got me thinking about this sort of stuff again. And I'm like, you know what? If I can nail this on my acoustic, I bet I can play it really, really well on the electric. And lo and behold, when I went back to my electric later that evening, even if I was just spending about 20 minutes working on this solo while Nina finished getting ready, I found myself like playing really, really great on my electric when I sat down to play this. And that muscle memory was just there. But because I'd confronted these difficult issues that didn't reveal themselves when I was playing with my electric guitar, I probably would never have actually dealt with that. I probably would have just left it as like, yeah, it sounds pretty good. Leave it be. It's fine. But now I have to really nail it. And I have to nail it, especially on a guitar that is tough like this one, if that makes sense. Anyway, guys, that is how your acoustic guitar can help to bulletproof your electric guitar technique or your guitar technique in general. But remember, these things we talked about today are not limited to the acoustic guitar. They extrapolate out to any guitar that is difficult to play. So that could be an electric guitar with a higher action or with stiffer strings, or it could just be an electric guitar with a tone that's a little more difficult. So that could be your kryptonite sound. So for example, if you have trouble controlling noise, you might dial in more gain than you're comfortable playing with. Or if you have, like me, if you struggle with that particular sound where there's distortion if you play a chord, but then it's really clean if you play single notes, I really struggle with that because my instinct is, why are all the notes not distorted? I must play harder. And it just provokes this tension response in me that shouldn't be there. Rather than just leaning in and going, well, okay, this is just what the notes do. I'm like, no, the chords are distorted, therefore the notes must also be distorted. So it's a difficult thing. Using these methods of confronting like little blind spots in your playing with challenging setups are really, really useful. And then when you come back to play your own stuff, man, it'll feel loads, loads easier. So anyway, we're going to take some questions, right? So if you guys have questions, drop them down below. I want to hear them, right? But in the time being, I just want to take a quick second and show you this. This is a course that might help with this stuff if you have some technical problems in your vocabulary. You'll probably do quite well with this. This is a course called Picking Strategies Part 1. It is, of course, available as part of your GI Plus membership. So any new members or anybody who's thinking about signing up for lessons, this is what you can go get. Check it out. Does your picking feel uncoordinated and sometimes you miss notes or fluff transitions from string to string, maybe a little bit like this? When in reality what you want is smooth and easy and transparent feeling picking, a bit like this. Or maybe you've been sold on the idea that there's one specific way that you have to pick on the guitar and everything else is wrong, but that particular cookie cutter approach just doesn't work for you. It feels unnatural. It almost feels like you're fighting your own body to try and make it work. Well, Picking Strategies Part 1 is the course for you. In this course, we explore the many different ways that you can form a full and complete and comprehensive picking approach by examining the various strategies used by some of the greatest pickers of all time. And there are a whole bunch of strategies out there, and I guarantee there is one that is going to work for your preferred picking mechanics, the way you prefer to stand or sit with the guitar, the type of guitar you play, the type of music you play. There is a strategy for you. We're going to explore all of them, and I'm going to show you how you can take a single solo study and play every line within it using all of the six picking strategies that we look at in this course. And of course, this entire course is available as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you're not signed up already, what better excuse do you need to sign up today? So there you go, guys, that's a look at Picking Strategies Part 1. It's a course that we have on all things picking related. It does help, right? It's a really, I think it's a great course. I'm very proud of it. A lot of people have had some great results with it, so we always love to hear that. So anyway, we have time for just a handful of quick questions. We're going to see how many of these we can get through. Here's a good one from Timothy Appling, though. Timothy says, do you think that the way an electric is more forgiving compared to an acoustic, playing an electric with effects is more forgiving than playing with no effects? I think it absolutely can be. So I think the thing with the electric guitar is a little bit like a photograph with a filter applied, if that makes sense. So if you take a photograph of yourself and you apply an Instagram filter to it, you can make yourself look better looking than you actually are. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. This is not a value judgment. If that's what people want to do, that's okay. No harm, no foul. People can do whatever they want to their photos, unless it's something misleading. Like, say, for example, transform your body in X days, and somebody's photoshopped some abs on themselves. That's different. But if it's just somebody, you know, wanting to feel better about themselves, I think there's no harm in that. Same way that playing the electric guitar with effects on and making yourself sound a little better, or making everything that you play sound better, rather, it's no harm in that. I think it's a good thing. You know, we don't need to perform with the kind of setup that we're talking about practicing with, where the practicing setup is revealing and punishing. A performance setup should be the opposite. It should be something that is facilitating you playing well. It should feel like the best thing in the world, and you play it and you go, yeah, this is great. I'm 10 times the guitarist on this than I am on other instruments. That's a good thing. We like that when it comes to performance. But when it comes to revealing tendencies in your practice like this, and I should also stress, by the way, that sort of thing is good. It's very good when you're practicing musical things, when you're working on your phrasing or your improvisation or all that sort of thing. The punishing setup like this is only really for practicing technique. That's all it's for, because when you're practicing musical ideas, the technique should be transparent. You know, it should just be something that happens. And you should, Nick's actually commented on this. He said something, I've lost the comment, but he said something to the same effect. So great observation, for sure. Now, your technique should be, it shouldn't be a thing that limits you when it comes to your musical choices. So when you're practicing your improv, let's say, or you're practicing your tone production, or your phrasing, and all that sort of stuff, that is where we want a guitar that cooperates with us. It's only when we're working on technique that we want a guitar that is challenging. But yes, to go back to that line of thinking, playing without effects can be a very good thing. And this includes things like reverb, for example. Reverb can really make things feel comfortable and easy because it just kind of fills in all the cracks, so to speak. So, you know, if we have notes that maybe don't quite come out, sometimes the reverb can just fill that hole. And we're not quite so aware of the fact the note didn't come out. Whereas if you have no reverb, it'll let you know. You'll know, right? Now, you shouldn't do this as some kind of like, I guess some self-flagellation thing when it comes to performance and go, no, I'm going to perform with the toughest possible setup. Literally nobody cares because nobody can tell, right? Nobody can tell how tough your setup is unless you go out of your way to tell them. And then they'll be like, yeah, I don't care, man. Like, do I like the sound of it or not? So when it's time for performance, be as flattering as you like with your tone. When it's time for technical practice, that's when it's time to be revealing. But it's a great observation, I think. So we've got time for probably one more. We got some really cool observations here very quickly. So Marcin says in there, I grabbed my PRS and playing difficulty was reduced. For sure. Now this is cool because you can actually use this as a preparatory exercise for performing. So you can get yourself used to playing technical stuff on, say for example, this guitar. And then if I was to switch from electric, man, it should feel like super fluent. So let's actually see if it has. So what I'll do here is I'll play some stuff on my acoustic. Yep, feeling timing's a little off. Now if I grab an electric, I'm gonna ask James to pass me his PRS, if he would be so good. We're gonna mute this real quick, and we'll see how much easier this feels off the back of our acoustic experimentation. So excuse the close-up on my midsection there. That's fine. It's okay. I'll breathe in. So we've got James' electric here. James' PRS is very nice. Just throwing it out there. It's a lovely guitar. But if we were to go to, for example, let's find my, hopefully this isn't crazy loud, but if I go to my all-purpose GI preset, which is on the same bank, let's find it. Where are you? Let's just find the guy. It's right here. There we go. So this should hopefully... Oop. We've got a dodgy cable. And a wall that's on. Should hopefully feel very easy. Well, pull the string off the fretboard. Yep, can confirm, feels really rather comfortable. So again, took a little bit of an adjustment. There was a brief period where it was like, okay, you know, this takes a minute to get all sorted, etc. But you know, it came together pretty quick. So I think that's a valuable thing. Definitely a valuable thing. So once again, you know, having to quickly adapt my technique to, okay, this guitar feels lighter now. Once I get used to the idea that this guitar feels a little different, we're flying, we're cooking. So anyway, guys, we've run clean out of time. Want to remind you, we're back next week, as we always are, Monday evenings. We do this every Monday. Next week, we are discussing what we learned from the Jared James Nichols session last week. Wanted to give you 2 weeks to ruminate on this. I'm going to encourage you to go check it out. It's a really great stream. We did it last week. It's available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. Jared's a great guy. And I'm going to encourage you to go watch the stream. It's really, really cool. Lots of insights. We're going to be going over that in more detail next Monday. So grab your electrics. We're back on the Easy Street guitar next week. In the meantime, I'm going to grab my acoustic one more time. And what we'll do is, I'm gonna ask James to, if you can, mute the sound of the quad cortex that we're playing through. I'm gonna grab this, we're gonna go back to our backing track, we're gonna play out and see if I can play any smoother than we did on the intro. So the same deal, this is our Fleetwood Mac style backing track, available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. Woo, lots of noises. While I find my acoustic preset again, where did I put it? It's up right about, where are you? Here, nice. Are we getting that coming through? There it is. So we'll play a little bit more. In the meantime, I will see you guys next week.